Good evening, everyone. Honorable, respected, and my dear friend and governor of Uttar Pradesh, your Chancellor Ramnaik ji, your Vice Chancellor, an eminent cancer specialist, Professor Bhatt, the dignitaries on the dais, off the dais, members of the press, the distinguished faculty members present here, the graduates, the proud graduates, who have, it is your day today, and their parents, members of the press, ladies and gentlemen, invited guests, if any. Convocation address is a time to remind the graduates who have just graduated to still have your feet on the ground while the head is in the ninth cloud. Congratulations. Let me first congratulate you for getting your degree and getting where you are. But let me remind you, your learning does not stop here. Getting a degree is only a license to learn more, especially in medicine, because the data now says new data pours into medical arena 7% per month. So if you don't study for 6 months, half of what you know has changed and you don't know which half it is. That's the problem. That's the problem with most of us. So you have to keep on studying till you die. The only time you stop studying is when you go under and or probably get burnt. The question is, what is this all about? What are we doing? It is time now occasionally to look back and take stock of what the profession is doing. And if you look at it today, the profession is nothing to really write home about. It has not set the Gomti on fire, nor has it set anybody in any. It's actually in very bad times. It's in the crossroads, looking which way to go. And when you are at the crossroads, it's better to take the road less traveled so that you take some new steps forwards. A lot has been talked about research. But let me remind you, my dear friends, that an audit of the best journals in the world, the so-called best journals, quote-unquote, has shown that 97% of the research data that is published there is not worth the paper on which it is written. Because what is research? Repetitional research. This is what we do. We repeat what others have done. That's called repetitive research, which is of no consequence at all. Because it is Karl Popper, a great thinker, a professor of science philosophy in the London School of Economics in the 50s, wrote one very important sentence. In Hindi, it is called Kahavat. He said, knowledge advances not by repeating known things, but by refuting false dogmas. It's only then that the knowledge goes forwards. And none of our research, not even one paper in the Indian journals that I know of, has taken knowledge forwards in any field, especially in medicine. I'll give you an example. 127 AD, Galen wrote that the liver pumps blood. For 1500 years, remember that? 1500 years, every professor of medicine, every researcher, everybody, every journal wrote that liver pumps blood. It was only in 1628, a thinking, ordinary, practicing doctor in London, who was not very busy but was curious about the world, seeing a small fire hydrant, thought that the blood comes and goes from the heart. So he wrote De Motu Cordis in 1628. William Harvey was his name. And for writing that, he was to be killed. Because if you oppose the great people in those days, you were either killed, poisoned, or sent into the mental hospital as a madman. So Harvey was to be killed. So some of his friends said, run for your life. So he ran out at darkness and walked up to Calais and took the boat, went to France, and was hiding in Germany for one full year. When the king called him back and said, look, your ideas are accepted, come back. Those days, you don't get an honorary degree or a PhD from the governor. You get the king's accepting it. That's then it becomes what is called thesis. Thesis is the pedestal on which the theory is kept. Hypothesis is something which cannot be kept up, so it is kept down under there. So the hypothesis becomes a thesis when the king accepts it. So the king accepted that, and William Harvey's De Motu Cordis, heart pumps blood. It took 1500 years in any area. Ptolemy in the 2nd century said sun goes around the earth. And for 5 centuries, every scientist said sun goes around the earth. It was only Copernicus in the 7th century who came and said, no, earth goes around the sun. So it took 500 years for knowledge to go forward. So I want you youngsters who have now got, you know, really charged with all your enthusiasm to do research which refutes false dogmas in medicine, of which there are plenty. Actually, medicine is full of false dogmas. Demolish them one by one. Then people will be happy. Actually, it was in the year 2002, I was invited for a convocation address in the White Memorial Center of the University of California in Los Angeles, where I introduced a concept called medical humanism. What we need is humanism. Anything that you do should have some comfort for the other human being. That's called the real art of medicine. You know what art is? Art is making another man's day. Art of medicine is making somebody comfortable, and that's the real humanism of medicine. So whatever is your degree, whatever is your encomiums, whatever are your achievements, see that the suffering humanity which needs your help gets what it wants. You don't know when you are well what you want. When you are ill, you want your doctor to be a god. You want your doctor to be the best human being that you have. And then if you are ill, you know you want a good doctor. But when someone else is ill, you have to be a good doctor if you really want to reciprocate that feeling. That's called medical humanism, a word which Comte in France introduced for business humanism. Humanism in business, humanism in medicine, humanism in science. Today what has happened is science has also lost its character. Science is actually inquiry. But today science has become a business. Science has become a religion. And science is so dogmatic, more dogmatic than religion. And today science has got so many myths which have to be demolished. Now let me say what research you have to do. Find out you have a problem. You know, every day you have a problem on the bedside. If you have a problem on the bedside, try to go as far away from the bed as you can to get an answer. That is called true research. And this is the only way we can take knowledge forwards in this area. One of the biggest stumbling blocks in medicine is dominance of one system over all other systems in treatment. That's the Western medical system. And why the Western medical system is believed to be the best? Because we were brought up in that education school. In school, we were told Western education is the best. We were told, and nobody talks about Indian education. It's only now, with Narendra Modi becoming the Prime Minister of the country, some people have started thinking about Indian education. Formerly, if you talk about Indian education, they say you are either a villager or you are uneducated. But truly, it's the West that wants Indian education today. Because Western education has no meaning at all. And Western education makes everybody same robot. Actually, no two human beings are alike. But the school wants you to be alike. And this is where our educational system has gone wrong. So unless we reform our school system, our research will not change also. So there's no use preaching to you at this stage. I should go and tell the primary school teachers what the child must be taught to think, T-H-I-N-K. Actually, you'll be surprised. I started Leave to Think, LTC, Leave to Think Club, when I became the dean of the medical school. The membership is for a person with a curious idea, he becomes a member. And then, if he has a curious idea, we give him all the support to do research. And you will be surprised, we got so many good things about it. One boy came up with an idea saying that, sir, why do mosquitoes go around your nose and your face only? Why don't they go around your leg? I said, why? Because they like carbon dioxide. And I said, so what? I said, sir, I'll get a small little device which generates carbon dioxide. Keep it in the room so it attracts all the mosquitoes and they can be killed, so that the man or the woman can sleep comfortably without mosquito bite. Because today we have all chemicals, you know. You see in the television chemicals. These will kill. Somebody said, oh, macharon ka hemorrhage hai. Then I told that man, oh, manushon ka bhi hemorrhage hoga, because it is the same biological cell that the man has also got. So they are as bad. But this is a great idea. This carbon dioxide is a great idea. Then he also said, sir, this neem oil repels mosquitoes. I said, how do you know? Let's do some research. So we had rats, two sets of rats. Shaved them clean and put them in the cages with a lot of mosquitoes. One of them we smeared with neem oil, and you would be surprised, there is not a single mosquito bite on the neem oil mosquitoes. So these ideas come when you only allow people to think. If you don't allow them to think and think like anything else and what is in the book, vomit it out and mug it up and then get the first rank. Then we say, oh, he's a great boy, he's first rank, he's second rank, he's gold medalist, he's this, he's that. Congratulations. But then it's only mediocrity, you are competing with others. Real excellence comes when you compete with yourself. You must try to be better tomorrow than what you are today. That's called excellence. Mediocrity is competing with others. I am first in the class. So if you are first in your class, you may be the last in the whole country. So it doesn't mean anything. It's only mediocrity. So we are only encouraging mediocrity in this country now. Now that's not good. Actually, you know, you'll be surprised. When I congratulate all the gold medalists here, I congratulate more those who did not get the gold medalist. Do you know why? It is they who made you get the gold medal. You are only comparing with them. So you got a gold medal because someone else didn't get the gold medal and someone else was not as good as you are. So this kind of education must stop, and we must have excellent education where every student says, I am better today than what I was yesterday. Every teacher says, I am better today than what I was yesterday. Every researcher says, I am better today than what I was yesterday. Because today what we have to do is, if you want to start a university or an institution, what we look for in our country is a building. We must have a big building. We must have big infrastructure, we must have laboratories, we must have this, that. When Britain, after the Second World War, wanted to start one of the best postgraduate medical institutions called Postgraduate Medical School or Hammersmith Hospital, do you know what they looked for? The Parliament decided, catch hold of the brightest four brains in England, in UK. So they went around the country at that time and they picked up four people. Sheila Sherlock in Edinburgh, she was 29 years old. She was just a fresh MD and they picked her up. Then Shafi Schaefer in London and McMichael, John McMichael in Middlesex. Then they had Christopher Booth from North. And they said, start an institution. Do you know where they started? In the military barracks in Duquesne Street. Even today, the postgraduate medical school is in a military barracks. It doesn't have a proper building. But what is the quality of work that goes on? On Thursday afternoon, there is a clinical meeting in Hammersmith Hospital, which is presided over for 44 years by one man, Christopher Booth. One man presides over. And you get people from all over the world coming, presenting their peculiar cases. And you would be surprised, this man moderates everything. And everybody is shivering to come to Hammersmith Hospital to present a case. That is the quality of work. And Sheila Sherlock changed the face of liver disease. Up until Sheila Sherlock came on the scene, hepatitis was a pus in the liver. She changed it. Christopher Booth and McMichael, they wanted to show that a catheter can be pushed into the heart. So they wrote down a letter to their wives. If they died, it is not the other man's mistake, it is his own mistake. So he said, Christopher Booth, you push your catheter into my heart, I'll push my catheter into your heart. So they lied down, pushed it, and when they didn't die, they knew heart can be catheterized. So that's the kind of research you do. That's called refutative research. And I want our students to do refutative research. One more thing that we can learn, some good things we can learn from the West, which you don't try to learn. All bad things we learn very quickly. Some of the institutions in the West are maintained by their alumni. You will be surprised, Harvard University and even New York University, Columbia University, they're all maintained by their alumni. Now you will all become very big people, you know, you'll become very big doctor, you'll become very big businessman, you'll probably become have a corporate hospital and loot the world. But share a part of that booty with the King George's Medical College. I am also an alumnus of King George's Medical College. I'm very proud of myself. I don't know if you have a very strong alumni association. And a few years ago I got a letter saying that we have an association, come and join. So I said, okay, I came. And then it fizzled out, you know, it's like soda water enthusiasm. When you press the cork and the ball goes down, it comes out like that. And then settles down, like the beer that settles down. That should not be the thing. I want a very strong alumni association, KGMC, which will maintain and probably partly share the expenses of the university as well as its development and research. One more thing, ladies and gentlemen, congratulations for where you are today. But remember, you will be an ambassador of King George's Medical College all over the world for the rest of your life. Don't monkey around. Whatever you do, the society looks at you and says, he is a Georgian. And to be a Georgian is a pride. And maintain that with, you know what is the greatest quality of a human brain, educated human brain? Humility. The higher you go, the humbler you should be. There's a small little stanza in my language, Kannada, which says, Yeruvanu Ravi, sun goes up, Kattaludana Jagaladuvan, fighting the darkness. Yeridantele Chikkavanagi Thoruvan, when he goes up, he becomes smaller and smaller. Yeridavanu Chikkavanagi Rebeke, Emba Matan Jagake Sarvan. When you go up, you must be humbler, is the message that sun gives to you every morning. You see the sun in the morning is so big. When he goes up, he becomes smaller and smaller and smaller. And as he goes up, he becomes very small. So friends, today you are MD, ABCD, EFG, and all kinds of things. We are degree mad people in India. We want for everything one degree. One degree for after. See, in if you go to London, England, there's no degree if you want to specialize. You must be a specialist registered for which you have to have training. It's only training that gives you. Today here, nothing. You get your MBBS by mugging the book and then sit again in the library to get the entrance test mugging. You hardly see the patients. You hardly don't want to get any experience. Then you get another degree. You get MD. Then you again mug up and get a DM. And then you call yourself a specialist and immediately become a specialist without a day's experience. Remember, it's not knowledge that matters. It is wisdom that matters. Wisdom requires lot of experience, lot of thinking, lot of anubhuti. You know anubhuti? Making mistakes and learning from it. Anubhava is what you do. Lot of people say, I have got 40 years of anubhava as a teacher. You must be the same as that you were 40 years ago that you are today also. But I have got 40 years anubhuti means I have suffered and learned from my mistakes and become a better man every day. I want you to have anubhuti before you call yourself a specialist. Don't call yourself a specialist tomorrow because you got a degree. This is only in India that we see the day you get a degree, you become a specialist. In the West, you've got to have training, 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 experience, experience, experience. It's the experience that matters. And I was so happy to see, today I met your head of the Department of Cardiac Surgery. And this gentleman was with my son-in-law. Both of them were in Birmingham Hospital, in QU2 Hospital in Birmingham, doing cardiac surgery training. And you ask him, what is the kind of people that they have for cardiac surgery? And they have so much of humility, I tell you. When I was a trainee in the Middlesex Hospital Medical School, we had a cardiac surgeon. She was a big woman. She was like a man. You know, Miss Shepherd was her name. She's 6 feet tall and always smoking a cigarette. So I used to ask her, Mary, you are a cardiothoracic surgeon. And you know one of the important causes of cancer lung is... She said, I just want to get cancer lung and die. That's why I'm smoking. And that's the kind of woman she was. And she would do valve replacement, I remember still, and then keep the patient in the intensive care unit for 1 week. Patient can't come out of the ICU for 1 week. Then came a young, dashing young man picked up by the National Heart Hospital. Magdi Yaqub was his name. He's an Egyptian who came to England to study and then settled out there as a cardiac surgeon. And Magdi would do a valve replacement today and make the patient walk tomorrow. Now look at the ego. Mary never said anything. One day Mary told me, she called me and said, look, I'm not doing valve replacements from tomorrow. Let Magdi do it. He's a better hand than me. See, that's the humility I want you to develop. What we would have done, you're jealous of because Magdi is her assistant. She is the boss. And she would never admit that Magdi is better than her. But here is a lady who says, Magdi is better than me. Let Magdi do what I'll not do. I'll do something else. That's the kind of people we must develop to go on in this world. Now, friends, I'll have to remind you something. Your parents have looked after you so well. They supported you, they loved you, they even funded you, which happens only in India. And today you are somebody. Please don't forget them when they're old. Don't send them like West to the old age home. You know what misery they have in the old age home? They may have money, they may have comforts, but they're not happy. I had a patient when I was a cardiac registrar in London. This old lady had a cardiac failure getting repeatedly admitted and she had so many tablets and so much money. One day she told me and called me and said, Professor Hegde, I don't want any one of these. Please tell the NHS not to spend so much money on me. You know what I want? I want to see my son's face once. He left me 28 years ago and went and settled in Australia. Never come back to see me. I want to go there. I don't have money. All these tablets can be sold in the market and get me one return ticket to Australia, and my heart failure will disappear. Can you believe that? And that's the kind of love they are missing. Please look after your parents as long as you live, because as long as they live. And don't let them suffer in the intensive care unit at the last days. If you think their end is almost there, leave them in peace with their near and dear ones and to die in dignity. Today, death has lost its dignity because the last 10 days in the intensive care unit in corporate hospitals in America makes 90% of their profit. So you keep the patient in the intensive care unit, put him in a monitor, and then put him on the respirator, and he is dead, but the monitor goes on. And then you say, oh, there's a moral responsibility. When do I stop it? How can I kill him? This is the problem. In the first place, you killed him long ago when you put it in that machine. But now you say you don't want to stop that machine. Then you go to the court and say, court must give a judgment as to when the machine has to be stopped. So look after your parents. Now parents, look after your children as long as you live. Because today your responsibility is not over because your child has got a degree. You have to give the same love, care and compassion for your child as long as you live, because that is what keeps them going. It's mutual love between the parents and the children that keeps you going. Now third thing is, for all the other students aspiring to come to this medical school, I always tell you, if you want to become a doctor, think before you jump. First find out if you are comfortable looking after the sick. Many of us are not. And many of us would not have, because you know, I get mad when students come to me and say, sir, it's a very interesting case for clinics. What is interesting? The young boy of 16 dying of heart failure with 4 valve disease and lot of murmurs there. They say, interesting. I said, I want you to think for a minute, empathize with that boy. You lie down in that bed with all your 4 valves gone. Do you want me to say you are very interesting? You wouldn't want. So have some sympathy. I always tell doctors jokingly, whether you're allopath, homeopath, umopath or whatever, have sympathy and empathy, you'll be a good doctor. So the most important quality of a good doctor is a good human being. I want a doctor to be a good human being so that patients develop faith in you. You don't demand faith, you command faith. You know, I always say, we have teachers who say, when I go to the class, sir, students don't stand up, why don't you pass a rule saying that everybody should stand up when a teacher enters the class? I said, no, your stature must be such that the student can't sit when you enter the class. I still remember the days when Sarvapalli Radhakrishnan was the vice chancellor of the Benares Hindu University. Whenever he walks into the office, everybody will stand automatically. Nobody is asked to stand, but they stand automatically because they respect his stature as a teacher. They respect his stature as a educationist. Today, educationist is one who owns an educational institution. That's not educationist. Education is a real man who has done some hard work in the educational field. I want you to do that. And I want you to come up and become that. Now let me congratulate the parents for their children's success. Let me congratulate the teachers. It's the teachers who are responsible. You know, William Harvey Osler said, it's not the buildings, it's not the brick, it's not the mortar, it's not the money that makes. It makes men and women of stature who have the good of their students at heart and work day and night to bring out the best student in the institution. They are the ones most respected. So you respected faculty members present here, you are responsible for what these boys and girls are. So congratulations for you. Keep up that good work. Institutions are built with men and women of quality, and I want you to be men and women of quality so that you deserve that name as a teacher. Lastly, the administrators, who are very important. And I found your vice chancellor, whom I met yesterday, a very good human being, because you know he's humble. That's the greatest quality. I don't consider PhD, MD, MS, DN as. I say a humble person is an educated person. An arrogant person is an illiterate. That's why our ancestors said, Vidya Dadati Vinaya, Vidya Vinaya Sampanna. And that is the quality I want. And here is a vice chancellor who is humble. So he is a right example for the students. Follow him. I have finished my 600 seconds given to me. So I have stopped because we teachers used to go by the calendar, not by the clock. And we start the class today and end tomorrow. But now I have started what Thomas Jefferson was told by his uncle when he became the President of the United States of America. He said, "Tom, now don't have your long-winded speeches. You stand up, speak up and sit up." So I have followed that now. I stand up, speak up and now I sit up. Thank you very much. Once again, let me thank your Vice Chancellor and your university for having the faith in me and calling me for the convocation. And I'm proud to say that this is the second convocation address that I'm giving in this university. I was here for a convocation address in the past when someone else was the Vice Chancellor. I still remember the day when I was given an honorary doctorate by the Tirupati Institute of Medical Sciences, a new university like KGMC which started in Andhra Pradesh. And I had not known anyone there. And a lady was the Vice Chancellor, so I went and told her, "How did I get this honor? Why did you call me?" She said, "Did you know me? Or did anybody? I didn't know. I have not been influencing. I have not talked to anybody." She said, "No, sir. I had so much of pressure from my academic council to give you an honorary degree that I couldn't help it. I didn't want to give, but I couldn't help it." So here you are. I still remember that because, you know, it sometimes happens. You know, you just wonder what happens. And I was wondering. I had a stroke recently. I couldn't speak. I couldn't walk. Now, thank God, I have come back because all my students were my doctors, my nurses, and my physiotherapists. And they saw to it that I recovered and I have come back. Thank God for that. I don't know. Nobody knows the future because only God knows that. But right now, I am able to talk and stand. And today, I had my endurance test because morning I stood for 1 hour and spoke. And then for 2 hours, they ate my head. They were asking me questions. They wouldn't tell me. And I went to my hotel at about 2 o'clock. Then they said, "Governor Saab is coming. Come quickly." So very quickly, I had this fancy dress changing. And one other thing that I liked about this university is it was I who first started the movement against the Western dress in Indian convocations when I became the Vice Chancellor. My whole university was against me. But I got in designing institution in Ahmedabad, fashion designers, and made them look at the convocation dresses of Nalanda and Taxila universities and got that made for our university. And I refused to wear the gowns, you know, that fancy dress that you have for convocations and the funny hat. Whenever they called me for a convocation address, I refused to have that. I used to have my dress only. But here, I asked the Vice Chancellor yesterday, he said, "No sir, you come in whatever dress you want to come, we'll give you a shawl." I was so happy, I tell you. I said, "Here is a university which is trying to be Indian. And I'm so proud it's my university and that's my happiness, Doctor. But thank you very much for that. I tell you, we look so good in our dress. I want to see these girls in a beautiful sari. And the boys and girls in that nice dress which our governor has, you know, that kind of a, I want that full sleeve shirt, khadi made shirt, and then probably a pajama or even a kacha. We have a kacha, a nice kacha, and a cap which is ours, Gandhi cap. Instead, we have this ecumenical dress, not a university dress. Mind you, the Western universities were not educational institutions, they were churches. In the 12th century, they all became universities. And you have the same dress, same designation, chancellor, vice-chancellor, deacon, registrar, dean. These are all church nomenclatures. We continue the same thing. We don't say kuladipati, kulapati. We don't like that. We still want the Western things. Vice-chancellor. I don't know what is. Chancellor with vices or the other way around. So let us be Indian. Let us think Indian. Because India is great. You don't know what India is. You go to the West, they want India. One scientist told me, a great scientist who is Nobel laureate, told me, "Look, whatever I have done in physics is from the Vedas. I have got everything from the Vedas." And he wrote that in his paper. He has written a paper for you. Matter is not made out of matter. Please go to the internet this evening. Matter is not made out of matter. His name is Hans Peter Dürer. Hans Peter Dürer. And see that paper where he writes. I said energy is matter, matter is energy because there is no matter. I found there is no matter when I was searching for matter. But this was said by the Indian sages thousands of years ago as Advaita. And he says this one stanza which I am quoting from the Upanishad through the Bhagavad Gita says whole of quantum physics. Bahirantasya bhutanam charam acharamevacha sukshmavate tavijnayam durastam cha aniketa cha tat. That tat was misinterpreted as God and the whole science disappeared. Tat is electron. And you can't see God because you can't see electron. Why can't you see an electron? Let's see, anybody here? Any student? Why can't you see an electron? You can't see God, you can't see electron. Have you seen the wind? Christina, an American poet, writes, who has seen the wind? Neither you nor I. But the wind blows and the trees bend and dance, the wind is passing by. Who has seen God? Neither you nor I. But when you are in trouble, you feel God. And same way, electron cannot be seen because when you look at an electron, to be seen, a few photons will have to leave it. If one photon leaves an electron, it no longer remains the same electron. So nobody has seen an electron. But they have described the electron in various ways and got Nobel Prizes. That's all the Western science. And science has to change, my dear friends. Science is change. And medical science has to change. And medical science's future is in integration of all systems of medicine. In the healing art, there isn't anything called cure. Hippocrates wrote, cure rarely, comfort mostly, but console always. But cure, you can't cure, but you can heal. Healing is making you whole. Even common cold cannot be cured, but you can be healed even with cancer. I have had patients with cancer who are healed, who have made a life again and lived forever. Thank you very much. Once again, God bless you.